Okay, welcome to the video. The truth is, pragmatic truth is, this body is a communication device that spirit is using, trying to use here. Spirit's trying to get a message through to the world. That's why this body appeared here in the world, to tell it like it is, tell us what our options are. And here are our options, actually. We have a choice between two options here, pragmatically. From an existential, pragmatic standpoint, we have a choice of our experiencing here. Two experiences we can have. And they're mutually exclusive, actually. One, we can choose the confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex. Okay. Or, and the other option is, we can choose the clarity, continuity, fear complex. That's the only choice we have here as far as experiencing. From a pragmatic standpoint. Now, ultimately, when we choose the clarity, continuity, fear complex, this evaporates the continuity fear through familiarity with clarity. This is how we evaporate continuity fears, familiarity with clarity. And once the continuity fear is evaporated, then we have we're just abiding clarity. But this is not a existential, pragmatic option, because it's only reached through, you know, choosing this option of clarity, continuity, fear complex. So we have one choice. Pragmatically, everyone has one choice. Which of these do they choose? So this is the truth. This is what I came to tell everyone. Everyone says they're trapped, they're trapped, they're trapped. No, they're not trapped. Nobody's trapped. We're not trapped at all. It's simply we don't recognize we have this choice to make. Now, I can go on and on and on and clarify that, you know, the choice, and but it's important to deliver this message. This is what I came here for, to do. It's very difficult to get a communication device here to say this, because the all other communication devices, bodies in this world, are insisting that you can't say this. You know, and saying this is totally wrong. So it's very difficult. But this is the truth. This is the pragmatic truth of our situation here, that there's no way around it. There's no magical. Confusion believes in magic. So it always believes there's a way around the continuity fear. We don't have to choose that option. Confusion can magically work. No, it cannot. We have imagined that we have a need, an imaginary need to relate to nothing, to have some relationship with nothing. We don't have such a need, but we're imagining we have such a need. So we're trying to evaluate, how do we evaluate nothing to relate with it? And confusion is this so-called evaluation of nothing. And confusion, we keep telling ourselves, ultimately, we'll get it. You know, we'll be able to relate to nothing. But we're waiting for nothing to respond. It hasn't responded yet. And of course, it never will. How can nothing respond? So confusion is a waiting game, and it never works. And the matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex is just all the tricks we use to keep us waiting in confusion. Gets nowhere. Futile from the very beginning. And yet, when we want to stop it, we become aware of this continuity fear. And so where did that come from? Well, it's because we're not familiar with clarity anymore, because we've been abiding in confusion for so long. And then you think, oh, wait a minute, if I go back to confusion, the continuity fear will disappear. Yes, it's still there, but of course, when we go back into confusion, we're confused. So we're trying to make a way for confusion to be happy. We're trying to be happy with confusion. And that's the confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex. This is what it's working on. How can we be happy with confusion? So the real message here is that there is just a simple choice, and then choosing the obvious choice is to choose clarity, continuity, fear. Why? Because that's not a dead end. Confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex is a dead end, nothing but a dead end. That's all it is. You're just waiting for nothing to happen. It never happens. There is no fixated self to relate with, to relate to. Doesn't matter how much empathy training we are undergoing here, suffering and all this stuff, vulnerability training. There is no fixated self to relate to. It never will be. So we're waiting in vain. It's a dead end. The clarity, continuity, fear complex is not a dead end at all, because it's really the path of it's the way of getting used to clarity. And you have to do it bit by bit by bit by bit by bit. Pragmatically, we have to do it bit by bit by bit. Isn't it? Magic doesn't work. Clarity is not magic. Truth is not magic. It's true. So we get a glimpse of clarity. We spend some time with clarity, and then we have to full stop in the wow. Full stop in the wow. Now, what the confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex always says is, well, compromise. Well, how do you compromise between everything and nothing? Between truth and nothing at all? If there's only one oneness, how can we compromise? The belief that we can compromise is confusion. So when we're invited into compromise on this, well, let's choose both. Let's choose both clarity, continuity, fear complex, and the confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, egoic complex. Let's choose both of those. Let's compromise. This is confusion. Compromise is confusion. So we're just inviting ourselves to keep abiding in confusion when we talk about compromise. We don't have a compromise. We have a choice. Choice, not compromise. Choice. It's like you can't have both an abortion and not an abortion, and a baby, you know, a live baby and an abortion, dead abortion. You can't have it both ways. And we keep trying to figure out, well, how can we have it both ways? This is confusion. The belief that we can have both truth and lies true is confusion. But we keep labeling it as compromise. This is a misdefinition. Very, very nasty, bad misdefinition. We have to bring this to light. So the only problem we have is the continuity fear problem. That is the only problem we have. That is the truth. Confusion isn't a problem. Okay. It's not a problem. It's continuity fears that's the problem. Confusion is suffering, but we can drop it, okay? We can choose not to suffer that confusion. However, we can't really choose not to have continuity fear, so that's why it's a problem, because our lack of familiarity with clarity and with truth makes us feel jittery, like, oh, I'm going to experience some discontinuity effect. And I'll lose my identity in the discontinuity of it. So that is a problem. It's the only problem we have. There isn't any other problem whatsoever. This is the basic avowal, you know, profession, to profess. The basic, we don't call it confession, but a confessor, continuity, it's a basic assertion that yes, I do have a problem. I do have one problem. It's the continuity problem. It's the only problem there is. Confusion is not a problem. Only continuity, fear is a problem for me. It's the only problem there is. Yes, it's a big problem. It's a huge problem. I have to work at it gradually, which is a relief, right? We don't really want a problem we can get rid of instantly. It's because it frightens us. We're glad to see it's a big problem, actually. So, oh, wow, good. It'll take a while for me to evaporate this. It's a relief to see that. We don't want to see, oh, I had this flimsy problem, and poof, it's gone, and now, you know, I'm back to perfect clarity again. Ideally, we think, "Oh, that's nice," but pragmatically, it doesn't work that way. We're too frightened of this. So it's strictly a matter of familiarity. Strictly a matter of familiarity. That is a problem. Familiarity, continuity problem is a problem for us. Big problem. But it's the only problem we have. The other stuff that we're claiming a problem isn't really a problem at all. It doesn't exist. This false need doesn't exist. We don't have to get rid of what doesn't exist. See, the way that we've been looking at it, we think that God has a problem. That somehow God has been confused. No, God has not been confused. Therefore, confusion is not a problem. So, it is possible to see this clearly, but then again, that gives rise to continuity fear. And then we have to practice the wow. So you have to go somewhat on faith on someone who tells you this at first, because you say, well, how do I know this is true? If I see it's true, I'll be so clear it'll frighten me, which is true. So it is a bit of a conundrum, but compromise is not the answer to this conundrum. Practice is. Faith and practice is the answer to it. You have to have this underlying faith that, yeah, this is, I know this is true. That nothing is happening to us. This whole empathy program, we are the ones who have made this entire program up to try and train ourselves to prepare for the birth of a fixated self, a new creation, a fixated creation, where freedom is now, where fixation is freedom and freedom is fixation. You're backwards of creation, trying to reverse creation. And so what confusion says is that we're fearing eventual continuity fear. If we don't train empathy training properly, a vulnerability training, then we'll have a continuity problem once this fixated self emerges somehow, magically becomes real, or we realize, oh, this was always been real, you know, we just didn't see it, and reality was the dream. When confusion says, when that happens, if we haven't trained with vulnerability, that we won't be able to then function. We'll have a terrible continuity problem in functioning. So confusion says continuity fear is a problem, you know, that not yet encountered. It's in the future. But we can avoid it entirely by this vulnerability training. Okay, suffering, misery, feeling imperiled body, you know, the body is imperiled in all from all sides. That's what confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal complex, is egoic complex, is telling us, okay. What the clarity, continuity fear complex is telling us is that the continuity fear already exists. It's already with us. It's already here. And you become aware that it's already here by turning towards clarity. And then seeing some clarity, and then saying, whoa, what is this fear I'm experiencing? And it's a continuity fear. But the good thing about this is that you realize, hey, it's already here. It means I can work on it right now. You see, with confusion, it says that suffering is the way to avoid continuity fear. What we say is that the continuity fear is actually already here, and that directly working on it through full stop in the wow, clarity, full stop in the wow. Assertions, full stop in the wow, flipping the script, this basic spiritual practice. We can work on that right now and evaporate the continuity fear, which is leaving us with only clarity, which knows that there isn't any need to relate to fixation, because fixation doesn't exist. It never will. We're absolutely free. There is no fixation in reality. So why do we need to learn to relate to fixation as if it was a new reality? We don't. There isn't any such need. We invented such a need. God did not put such a need within us. That's a big lie. Maybe it's the biggest lie of all. And so many have been saying this. The confusion, matriarchal, patriarchal, ego complex is promoting this lie that this is all play of God. That God put this need in us to relate to fixation. This is not true at all. This is not true at all. God did not put any such need. There are no needs in reality. There's only freedom. We're the ones who tried to play with freedom and seeing if we could reverse it and fixate it. Spirit did this, not God, not God. So we have devised this empathy training program to solve what we see would be the continuity problem, because we wouldn't know how to function in this new reality of fixation. So we're trying to overcome a potential continuity problem that we're seeing by all this suffering. But when we see that there's never going to be any fixated self at all, then there's no need to train to function in such a creation at all. No need for all this empathy training. But then when we see that, we say, whoa, wait a minute, I'm so used to this, you know. It scares me. This is the continuity fear. So this is why I say that because there is no need at all to try and relate to fixation, because there never can be any fixation. Fixation isn't a problem. It doesn't exist. Learning to relate to it isn't a problem, because it doesn't exist. It's just a non-possibility. So so you can't really speak of it as a problem. We don't have that problem. We're not stuck with that at all. However, continuity fear is a problem, because it makes us feel that we are stuck with it. It's the continuity fear that makes us feel stuck with this confusion, really. It's not the confusion. It's not all the stuff that is making us feel stuck, actually. It's the continuity fear that's making us feel stuck. And it's here right now, so we can work on it. This is the great thing that I experienced. And the grace of God, the Holy Spirit, said, look, all you need to do is just work on it now, bit by bit by bit, and eventually it'll be all evaporated. So I said, okay, I could do that, because it's right here now. I could work on this. And as I worked on it, I've been working on it every day. So everyone else, most people in the world, almost everyone else, they're waiting, they're suffering, thinking this will get rid of the continuity problem in the future in relation to how do I function in a fixated creation of fixation, fixated freedom. And so they think that, you know, just going through the feeling of being imperiled in the body, in a world, that this is the right training to be doing, and that they will never have to deal with continuity fear. So they think that they're taking a superior path. So, well, we don't need to deal with continuity fear. We're sidestepping continuity fear. No, they're not. They're just delaying it, kicking it down the road into what they think is the future. But the future is always now. So they have to keep doing it constantly. They can never rest. Always, you know, there's a feeling of wanting to go back to clarity and drop confusion, which then the continuity fear comes up, and then they misinterpret it and say, oh, if I just suffer more, I can avoid this, and kick it down in the future, and it just goes on and on, another birth, just like that. It keeps going and going and going until at some point you say, hey, I do have a problem. I actually have a problem, continuity fear problem, but it's right here, right now, and therefore I can go to work on it and start evaporating it bit by bit. And so how do we evaporate it? Well, we need these qualities, these characteristics that we've projected on females and males. We've projected various qualities of, like, patience, humility, patience, willful determination, willful perseverance, and willful being very adamant and one-minded and focused. You know, there's different qualities we projected on males, different qualities projected on female bodies. These are really spiritual qualities. They have nothing to do really with male or females. We've just been projecting them. We have all these qualities within. Everyone does. We are not male body. We're not female body. We're spirit. So we have all these qualities within us. We have to use them. We don't need to get into a special dependency relationship and think, well, I don't have those qualities, I have to rely on you for these qualities and stuff. No. When we start practicing, spiritual practicing, the wow, full stop on the wow, this requires us to use this determination, this willfulness, to say, hey, I'm going to stop right now, that's it. And I'm just going to, and then the patience comes. I'm going to be very patient and gentle with myself. You see, these various patience, gentleness, and then adamancy and will and all. We have all these qualities. Spirit has all these qualities. So don't try to bifurcate it in terms of genders. This is a projection upon bodies. Bodies don't have any needs. They don't have any qualities at all, actually. Everything is a mental projection upon the bodies to deceive ourselves. To confuse ourselves, actually. But we all say, well, I can't do this, you know, I can't do this, I need the help of some other body, you know, I need the help of a body. That's confusion. It's a belief in compromise, which is really confusion. Let's say, I need a relationship with confusion. I need a relationship with fixation, and I'm confused as how to do that because it doesn't exist. Of course, it's confusion. When we try to relate to what doesn't exist, how can we not be confused? When we try to evaluate what can never exist, how can we not be confused in this evaluation? So the discipline. We all have discipline. The discipline is to full stop in the wow, look at clarity, and then say that's enough. I'm feeling this continuity, fear arising, and then be quiet for a while. Don't go into compromise, which is confusion. Compromise is confusion. And so when we start struggling, we're into confusion, actually. When we start feeling this, now I'm starting to really struggle. This is attempting at compromise, which is nothing but actual trying to evaluate nothing, which is confusion. When we say, well, I'm evaluating clarity, but I got this continuity fear, so maybe if I go back to evaluating nothing, evaluate both everything and nothing, then I won't have such a trouble. No, then we go into confusion. And then you lose the clarity, you know. That's what happens. You don't make clarity the new norm. You go back to confusion as the norm, what is normal. So, have to draw a line. When the wow gets really intense, spiritual buzzes there, you draw a line and say, okay, it's okay if I don't hear anything else right now. I don't have to make any more progress at this point. Especially progress with confusion, right? No progress in any direction. This is very important, neither towards clarity nor towards confusion. No progress and no backsliding. No affinity either way, neither nor. I'm just in this neither nor-ness of a full stop in the wow. This is what has to be practiced. And what this does is establishes a new normal. And this is where everyone comes up short. Or I put it another way, this is where we all struggle, is we keep trying to go back to an old normal. So I feel this stress here, let me go back to what I'm used to. Instead, we say no, I'm neither going towards clarity nor retreating away from it back to confusion. I'm making this the new normal. And this is where the patience and perseverance and will comes in. Those qualities that we have. Everyone has them. Whether we all have it, a spirit. And we insist that this is going to be my new normal right now. For now, for today. Now, maybe tomorrow we'll establish an even better new normal, closer to pure clarity. Maybe, but we're not predicting that. We're not going to predict anything because this is the new normal where we feel comfortable. We're not making predictions, thinking about where we're going to go. It's hard to feel like a house is your home when you're thinking about moving somewhere else as soon as you get there. You know, your mind's not on, your mind doesn't allow where you are to sink into you. So what we do is we allow the clarity that we experience, we allow this to sink into us like we did it. We really did take a look at clarity. This is our new normal, our ability to look within very clearly is our new normal now. And then this is our home. We let it sink in. And this is done by neither going one direction or the other, not trying to relate to anything in particular. We're relating to our new normal, which is our capacity. Our new normal is the realization we have this capacity to look within very clearly. I didn't know I had that capacity. So we have to make the new normal. Yes, I do have that capacity to to see through confusion, you know, to recognize, oh, that's not what I really want. And I don't need it. I don't have this need to relate to nothing, to fixation. So this is the path. This is the way. This is how I see it. This is what I came to say here. Everyone says they're stuck, they're stuck, they're stuck, they're stuck. No. If you practice full stop on the wow, it's an intentional stuckness in order to establish a new norm. But then soon after that, you find you're able to go deeper into clarity. So you're not stuck. But if we spend all our time complaining, I'm stuck, I'm stuck, I'm stuck, and don't identify the problem of a continuity fear, then we will just, this is just confusion. And we keep waiting. We're confused about what's going on. So we cannot, you know, the idea that somehow we can get free of confusion by just being confused all the time is ridiculous. But that's what confusion tells us. That the way to get familiar with clarity is to spend all your time focusing on confusion. Now, all that does is get us familiar with confusion. The way to get familiar with clarity is to focus on clarity and then recognize there's a continuity fear aspect to this and intentionally stop, not as a stuckness, but as a neither norness. Full stop on the wow, neither norness. Intentionally do this for a while and allow the continuity fear to kind of, and make this the new norm. As we make this a new normal, the continuity fear evaporates around this, and we say, oh, I feel comfortable, and this is like this normal to me. This having this clarity is just normal to me. It's no big deal. And I can assert, this is what happens. This is what I've done. This is what happens. So what many people would consider, you know, extraordinary clarity to me is just normal. It's like, what? That's just normal for me now. I don't think anything of it. But all of this new normal has been the result of, you know, daily efforts, constantly moving my new normal to greater and greater clarity. Now, is it easy to full stop in the wild? Sure, it's easy. But is it also difficult? Sure, it's also difficult. It's neither nor and both. It's both and neither. When you're doing it, you're saying, that's easy. And then when you get pulled out of it, you say, oh, it's difficult. But one thing that is under our control is our effort. Everyday effort is under our control. So we have to control the things that we can control. We cannot force easiness upon it, because it's the more we try to force easiness, the more difficult it becomes. So we just have to have faith that this works, and then we don't struggle with it. And then when we don't struggle with it, then it's easy. As soon as we start losing faith, then we start saying, wait, I need to compromise. I mean, I need to go back to my confusion that I'm used to. Then it becomes difficult. So we have to keep pulling ourselves back, saying, no, let's not struggle. Just full stop in the wow here. Full stop in the wow. No struggle. Neither nor. And this requires, you know, discipline, perseverance, will, patience, faith, determination. This is just frozen up for some reason. I don't know why. Hopefully it's still recording. I don't know. Maybe this is the full stop in the wow that we're talking about here. Is this a full stop in the wow? Just full stop like this. Now, most of the time, we have a difficulty full stop in the wow because we say, well, I got to get a compromise here. The problem is confusion and clarity. Is it we need some compromises? No. believing there's a compromise is the confusion. Believing there's a compromise, that is the confusion. So it's like saying we need confusion, more confusion in order to compromise with confusion. In order to move away from confusion, we need more confusion. This is confusion, right? What we're really saying is we can avoid the continuity fear by pushing it in the future, claiming that through suffering we will eventually know how to function within fixation. So there won't be any continuity fear to deal with then. This is magical belief. Back to this. Oh, it's real. Let me see if this is still audio, still recording. Maybe not. I don't know if this is still recording. Is this still recording or not recording? Come on. I don't know. It just is acting weird. Camera's still on. I just don't know if there's any audio being recorded. And there's this. Maybe it is. I can't stop it. Once it started, I can't stop. I don't know. I should be able to. Hello? Hello? Is it recording? Yeah, okay. Okay, well, I guess it has been recording. This is really great. Full stop, you see? At full stop, I just said, okay, I'll just keep recording. And now it's back. Perfect example, at least for me, that you don't panic. You have faith in this. The panicking that says, I need to go back to what I'm used to. I need to go back to what I'm used to, which is what? Confusion. Relative confusion. I mean, if you've been working on clarity a lot, the confusion won't be as severe, but it's still confusion. It's not pure clarity. So what we do when we make this advance into much purer clarity, then we say, okay, we're gonna hunker down right here. We're not gonna advance or retreat at all. We're gonna just hold the progress we've made, and don't get tricked into trying to make more at this point. Just hold on to what we have right now, and don't refuse to be dragged back to the old normal. We're gonna establish a new normal. So it's the capacity to keep establishing a new normal, which is so important. And this is in relation to clarity, not in relationship to some special relationships or confusion. A lot of effort goes into establishing new norms with confusion. This is not the spiritual path that leads to recognition, freedom from confusion. That doesn't work, obviously. Many are try that. Like, let me try this confusion. I establish a new norm, trying to, you know, hold on to suffering. Confusion is just a tactic we're using to hold on to suffering, because suffering, we think, will free us from a potential continuity fear relating to how do we function in a fixated reality, because we have no idea how to function really in that way. Spirit is completely free. It has no idea how it would function in a fixated reality. So we're trying to get an idea of how it would be by this fashioning this world and bodies and vulnerability, by fashioning vulnerability, essentially, and then trying to experience vulnerability. This is how we've done it. We're the ones who are fashioning and holding this training program. There's no nature out there doing this to us. We're entirely in charge of this training program, 100%. There is no nature. There's nothing out there. It's all a mental projection of a training program of suffering, vulnerability. We've done all of this. We're projecting all of it. It's not real. It's just a training program. I mean, when we realize we don't need the training program, what do? We said, oh, I don't need this training program. So let me just honor my creativity in devising this training program by, you know, just seeing the beauty, the wonderfulness of all my creativity, but I don't need to do any more training. You know, I don't need to feel imperiled at all anymore. This feeling of being imperiled is the feeling that we're after here. And we're just waiting, thinking that if we just feel imperiled enough, that we won't have any more continuity fear when the fixated reality dawns upon us, that we think it will. And it will never dawn upon us. There is no fixated reality that will ever dawn upon us. So obviously then, we have a continuity problem because we got to go back to, reality as it is. It's not that we get rid of fixated reality. It will never arise. We have to accept it will never arise, which then gives rise to a continuity fear. When we glimpse this, say, I've forgotten how to function in reality, so to speak. Haven't really forgotten, but we feel there's a familiarity issue. And practically, there is a familiarity issue. So first, we honor our creative efforts here at this suffering program, really, is what it is. An imperilment program, a vulnerability training. We're trying to put ourselves through vulnerability training so then we can understand how to function within fixation, which is would be vulnerability from our standpoint. Maybe we don't know, maybe we do, maybe we don't. I know, I absolutely know. I can see this. I've been able to see this very clearly. But then that gives rise to, continuity fear within me, of course. Do I have to practice what I preach? If I don't, I get in trouble. So we try and just hang in there with confusion, with suffering, with impairment, using confusion as the tactic. It's just a tactic. We don't have to use confusion, actually. We can use clarity. Confusion is really just silly. That's why the reason just dispels it so easily. But again, we don't dispel confusion by focusing on it, because that just increases our familiarity with it. We dispel confusion by focusing on clarity, because then we get familiar with clarity, which dissolves the continuity problem, which is the only problem we have. Confusion is not really a problem. It's just intentional silliness, actually. It's just intentional. See, what is intentional from us? How can that be a problem? It's coming from us entirely, so we could just set it down. Change. I want something else. That's not a problem at all. Whereas the continuity fear is something that arises around the issue of familiarity. And so it doesn't feel as though it's really coming from us directly. It's like we're afraid of our own freedom. It's like that. So we can speak of it pragmatically as a problem we have. Temporary problem. We do have this temporary problem called the continuity fear. It's the only problem there is. Temporary problem there is, and there are no other problems. There are no permanent problems. There's only one temporary problem, and that's the continuity fear. We have zero permanent problems, none. But we do have one temporary problem, and it's the continuity fear, and that's the only temporary problem we have. This is the assertion of the spiritual path here. This is the prime assertion. Now, when I focused on making this assertion, and just this assertion, I experienced a vision of oneness. Absolutely did. I experienced pure clarity. Confusion vanished for me. Let's put it this way. Confusion vanished. Gone. I was perfectly clear. No confusion. And saw everything the way it really is. And now, then seeing that, I said, wow, how am I going to function on this? How am I going to relate this to everyone? And then so the continuity fear, came back. But it is true. If we were to just assert this, and nothing more than this, and be absolutely adamant about it, and practice this over and over and over, this would dispel our confusion very quickly, very quickly. But then, of course, then I said, well, what about all the people who don't do that? I was thinking, well, okay, we can dispel it quickly, but how do we dispel it a little more slowly? And so then I developed, this overall perspective of the neither nor practice, and, the assertion, full stop and the wow, flipping the script, so we get a sense. Well, we don't have to go so quickly. We can make a little more gradual progress, but the capacity to go quickly is always within us. However, I was so elated that I didn't know where to place this elation. As far as in the world, how can I, if it's unacknowledged by the world, I felt this would be completely unacknowledged. So I said, well, where do I How can I, where can I put this elation, or some or where people can say, oh, this is why you're elated, because they can't relate to what I would be talking about. So I see this as what I started struggling with then. Oh my gosh. And like, again, I said in the previous video, we then displace this elation on being free of confusion, because onto something else, like music, sex, drugs, rock and roll, I put it. Relationships, sex, drugs, rock and roll. We displace it onto one of those categories or some other ones, but this just takes the general sense of these categories and say, this is why I'm elated. And then people say, oh, you're in love. I see why you're elated. Oh, you're rocking out to this, you know, great disco beat or something. Oh, this is why you're elated. You're on drugs. Oh, this is why you're elated. So people can relate to that, so to speak, you know. Confusion can relate to that. It can't relate to the absence of confusion. It cannot relate to it. It says, well, that's in the future. Once we learn through our suffering how to relate to fixation, then we won't have any more confusion. But it can't be now. It has to be in the future. So when you experience no confusion in the now, nobody in this world can relate to that. They say, it's not possible. That it has to be in the future. Herein is the problem, right? For teachers here, teachers of God, teachers of truth, teachers of clarity, trying to come into this world and communicate, is there's no acknowledgement. The people don't understand what you're talking about. And so then you end up displacing onto sex, drugs, rock and roll, the elation. And then they think, oh, now I can relate. Now I can relate to you. You know, I understand what you're talking about now, because it's in the future, you know. And we're just rehearsing. It's really a form of suffering, a disguised form of suffering, which is accelerating our preparation for the birth of the fixated creation, and which won't happen until we're ready for it, of course. So, of course, it's always in the future. It's not here now, because we say it will only give birth when we're ready for it to be born. So we displace it on some form of suffering that we define as fun, you know, or it's not suffering or something. We define these various things like that. And this is what the world demands. This is what everyone here demands. They won't acknowledge anything other than that. So of course it's difficult to come into this world and experience freedom of from confusion right now. You know, right now. They say, why are you so elated? I mean, why are you just, you know, there's no confusion. You know, the fixated creation hasn't arisen yet, you know, or it hasn't, you know, or woken up, or we think maybe it's just sleeping, you need to wake it up. It hasn't happened yet. What are you doing? It must be from a different, must have a different reason. And they say, well, let me give you the reason. You're just missing that key. Let's have a special relationship together. Let's do drugs together. You know, this stuff. Let's listen to music together. Let's do something like that. This is the problem. This is the problem here. And this is what we have to recognize. We have, well, when I say this is part of the continuity fear problem, is the continuity fear has to displace the elation, all right? So in order to avoid that, we have to practice full stop in the wow. No sex, no drugs, no rock and roll. Don't displace it on any of that. The elation. When we see clarity, what does it mean? We're temporarily experiencing an absence of confusion. So to experience that, it's elation. We're just elated. And then we realize there's no acknowledgement. Oh, because you can't have this now. It must be in the future. So I need to then displace this onto something that is involved with suffering, actually. Confusion. A pleasurable form of confusion, as they'd like to say here. Yeah. So this is the world. This is the trouble. Okay, this is the part of the continuity fear trouble. But we can short circuit this by full stop in the wow. So this is how we evaporate the continuity fear, saying, okay, I'm elated, but I'm not going to say it's neither related to this nor is it related to that. All right. So why are you elated? Well, neither nor. It's neither coming from clarity nor is it coming from confusion. And what we're really saying is, I'm making this the new norm. I'm just working on making this a new norm. So I don't want to try to take an absolute position at this point. See? So it's just saying I have the right to not answer the question. So saying neither nor is basically saying I have the right to not respond to that, because I'm making this the new normal for me. And of course the world doesn't acknowledge that you have a right to do that either. It says, no, you're going in the wrong direction. So you could use the neither nor practice. It's a very powerful practice. It's a very empowering practice. Tremendously empowering practice, a neither nor practice. So this neither nor practice then deals with this displacement issue, which I discovered is part of the continuity fear trouble. Displacing our elation, like putting on guitar playing or something, you know. Sex, drugs, rock and roll. Let me. I'm so elated, you know. I'm playing making this music. Oh, this is so wonderful, and this kind of stuff. That's just when we're able to do full stop in the wow. We don't need to do that. We don't need that. We're not missing anything. Wow, there's way better. The spiritual path is way better than sex, drugs, and rock and roll. Way, 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 way better. Because you're actually experiencing absence of confusion. More and more absence of confusion, actually. And this is just brings more and more elation. But then you have to discipline yourself to don't project it onto this and this and that. But we will be tempted, no question about it. So just forgive yourself. When you succumb to temptation, say, oh, okay, just recognize, okay, I was displacing elation. I don't need to do that. If I just go back to full stop in the wow, I don't need to displace that elation. Because I'm just getting used to just this level of it right here, right now. I'm not projecting any more, nor am I projecting any less of it. We can do that. The problem is when we start trying to project more, then we start running back towards less. I say, whoa, 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 it's too much, so let me go to less. So we take as much clarity as we can tolerate for any practicing session, and then say, okay, I'm going to just get used to this tolerance level, this level of elation, but I'm not going to try to add more or subtract from it. Let me just make this the new normal. So there's this wisdom that we need, okay, and this is what I've been able to recognize. We need this pragmatic wisdom to keep establishing a new norm, a new tolerance level every day. Now, I've been going through this very intensely for a long time, and the intensity recently is way more intense elation, but it also isn't, because I've already gained a tolerance for a lot. So now it's just, and by elation I mean absence of confusion. I don't mean physical thrills, sex, drugs, rock and roll. I don't mean that sort of elation. That's not elation. Elation, or we call bliss, comes from absence of confusion, actually. Seeing that, oh wow, I don't need this training program of suffering at all. Not because it's worked and a fixated creation is about to arise, no. Because there is no need to relate to fixation, because I don't have such a need. God did not create me with such a need. I tried to invent it, but I cannot give myself needs. God created me the way I am. I cannot add to what I am as far as fundamentally having some need that God did not create. I have a need. I am free. That you can say that's a need. Well, we're already free, so you know, it's not something we have to fulfill, but we do have to act in, we do experience in freedom, absolute freedom. We cannot add a need to experience fixation. We cannot add that to what we are. It's impossible. So I am delivering the message I came here to deliver. Everyone said we're trapped. We're not trapped. The wisdom of the path of full stop on the wow. That wisdom, full stop. Continuity fear is the only problem I have. Full stop on the wow is the practice. This, practicing this, you realize we're not trapped at all. We just have this continuity fear. But before I came here, I felt all this, please, you know, for be compassionate, help us, be compassionate. Anyone with compassion, help us out. We're so trapped. So I, out of compassion, spirit said, okay, let me make an attempt here, help. And now I'm, you know, spirit's able to get through this communication. Thinking that we're trapped is refusal to recognize we have a continuity problem right now. As soon as we realize we have a continuity problem right now, we don't feel trapped anymore, plain and simple. As soon as I saw, I said, I'm not trapped. It was like almost 40 years ago. I said, I'm not trapped at all. I just have this big problem I have to work on. But I'm not trapped by it. I can evaporate it gradually. So how am I trapped? I'm not trapped. I'm not stuck at all. I just have this big problem I got to gradually remove through evaporation. But that doesn't mean I'm stuck. And so this feeling of being trapped is gone. It's gone. I don't really feel trapped. I'm still suffering, sure, because I still have, you know, some continuity fear, and therefore I'm still identifying with this training program of suffering. But I don't feel ultimately that I'm stuck or trapped. There's a way to get used to clarity, you see, to truth, to freedom. There's a way to get used to it that gradually. So that's a fundamentally different boat. Once we repent, once we decide, okay, nothing's happened to me. I'm doing this training program to myself. God isn't doing it to me. The idea that God is putting us through this training program is absolutely false. We are putting ourselves through it 100%. And once we realize that we're the ones putting us through this, ourselves through this training program, and we keep doing it because of continuity fear, not because there's a necessity, but because of continuity fear, then we're in a different boat, the boat of repentance, a boat of changing our mind about the situation. And then we realize, hey, I just have this big continuity problem, but I can evaporate it, so I'm not stuck, I'm going to get free. So I've always believed that I'm going to get free. From the moment that I repented, I realized I am going to get free, no doubt about it. In fact, I glimpsed my freedom. I said, oh, it's absolutely doable. But it's going to take a while. The Holy Spirit said, yeah, it'll take a lot of effort. It'll take your time. It'll take your effort. It'll take, you know, you have to focus on this. You can't give equal attention to confusion and clarity, because then you will just have zero change, and so you'll stick with what, no change in familiarity at all. And what are we familiar with? Confusion. So we'll just remain familiar with confusion, and it won't help us at all if we try to focus equally on both or try to focus on confusion at all, because this is the overwhelming familiarity we have. The problem is not familiarity with confusion, it's lack of familiarity with clarity. So this lack has to be changed, right? There isn't any other way. Clarity will show us there isn't any other way. Confusion always says, oh, there's a magical way to deal with it, you know, which is just silliness. It's just silly. Reason just shows, will show you this very easily. But then the wow will arise. This is what we experience. When we use reason, the wow arises. And we go, wow, I have the capacity to get free of this. Oh my gosh, I didn't know I had this capacity. This is kind of, this is elation. But I'm, you know, I don't know what to do with this elation. How can I... And I don't know if no one acknowledges this. And so, this, you know, in a culture that we have non-acknowledgement, it gets very difficult. So, of course, we feel trapped because it's actually very difficult. But that's not the same as being trapped. Is the more materialistic we become, the more delay tactics we employ, which in modern culture, society, we are in delay, in engaging massive delaying tactics. So to think we just need to wait a little longer, then fixation will be the new creation, and then we won't have any continuity problem because we'll be used to this being feeling imperiled and vulnerable. The more we do that, the more we feel trapped, the more difficult it seems to us. Even though we're not trapped, the continuity fear, you know, seems to get greater and greater and greater for us. And this is the trouble. So this is why people are saying we're trapped. No, it's not true. It's not true that we're trapped. We can never be trapped. What it means is we're doing wrong emphasis. That's all it really means. As long as we're trying to make confusion work for us, we will feel trapped. As soon as we recognize that continuity fear is the only problem we have, we no longer feel trapped. What happened to the trappedness? It was never really there. It was just a future belief, a condition of what we thought we would feel, you know, that we're trapped in fixation. But fixation never arises. So how can we be trapped in what never arises? So the problem isn't fixed trappedness, it's continuity fear. It's a misdefinition. So what we're suffering from here is a misdefinition of our situation. As long as we define it that way, we won't have the wisdom to work on it. As long as it's misdefined, we won't have the wisdom to work on it properly, and then it becomes a negative cycle. So we are in this very negative cycle now in this world, no question. But again, that never develops trappedness at all. It just keeps the continuity fear unworked upon. And so, you know, it remains this boogeyman, this problem, you know. It does. I had the dream of the boogeyman. I think I said that before. Contrast, boogeyman of contrast. Continuity fear around that, and I just mixed it in with white yogurt and it all blended in beautifully. Beautiful day today. Supposed to rain tomorrow. A little bit of rain, and then another 10 beautiful days. And at least it's trying, you know, trying to prime the pump here and get it going. We're praying for El Nino to deliver us from drought, a horrendous drought here. Pumping. It doesn't look that way because we've been pumping all the groundwater out, but pretty soon there'll be no more groundwater to pump out. So, you know, you look at California, everybody says, oh, I don't see any problem. Well, again, it's all done with wells and groundwater depleting all the aquifers. There's nothing, no water left under the ground. Then what do we do? Then, what is this? Imperilment training, folks. This is what we're doing. But is it doing it to us? No, we're doing it to ourselves. We're entirely in control. We could go vertical on everything instantly, which means nothing is attached. There is no dynamic that attaches any appearance to any other appearance whatsoever. So we can all change any appearance we want to instantly. If we want water, we can have water appear. If we want water to disappear, we can have water disappear. There's no actual nature at all. Nature doesn't exist. It doesn't exist at all. It's a delusion to say that nature exists. And therefore, that this a world, meaning you know, the world of dynamics, horizontal dynamics, time, space, process, form, that it exists. There isn't any such existence at all. There's no fixation. But this is a training program that we are undertaking to get ready for fixation. But we're still completely in control of the training program. Totally. But we're denying it so it seems realistic to us. You see, that's the whole point, is to deny it so it seems like this is really realistic and we can't change anything. We're stuck here. So we get trying to get used to being stuck in a fixated creation where we don't have any choice. We truly are fixated. So we're pretending, we're denying that we have anything to do with this, no control over it, which is simply not true at all. We have total control over everything here. But we say, yeah, but if we see that, it won't seem realistic. So it won't help us prepare for a fixated creation. Well, guess what? Fixated creation will never arise. There's no such thing. So we can't, and God didn't give us a need to prepare at all. We gave ourselves this, and we cannot give ourselves needs. So it's nothing, you know. We just have no choice but to just set this silly whim down, you know. And we have to get familiar with clarity in order to do that. And getting familiar with clarity brings up this wow reaction, always, which is elation. And then the fear, like, whoa, what do I do with this elation? Oh my gosh, whoa, what happened to the confusion? Oh wow, I'm not used to this. And then we just insist on, okay, I'm not going to backslide, but I'm not going to advance anymore. And let me just full stop in the wow. So I keep repeating over and over because this helps us full stop in the wow. Keep repeating. So we're just getting used to it, just getting familiar with it. And then after like practice, then you don't really want anything to do with pushing things further. Just cool out, chill out. And if you do feel like going further, you can, but be very careful that it doesn't relate in too much elation that again gets displaced, and then that really causes backsliding, very bad. I still have these stupid songs going through my head from that couple days ago. It's wow. It's trying to displace the elation onto that. You see. Trying to get some acknowledgement because the world doesn't acknowledge lack of confusion. It says, no, that's in the future. You can't have that now. And we try to displace elation often to beauty, form beauty, beauty of form, whether it be bodies, whether it be nature, landscapes. We say, oh, you know, your hair is so beautiful. Oh, this is so beautiful. Because then we're back into confusion. You say, oh, confusion can be wonderful. The elation of coming from a lack of confusion is being displaced. So, but pragmatically, there's going to be some displacement. You have to be very careful about it. Ideally, you can just stay in the full stop of the wow and until it wears off, and no displacement. That's ideal. That's ideal. It's possible to do it ideally, but we come up short from that. You have to be very careful. We all do. I'm going to go out in nature later on today. I've got to be very careful not to fixate on it. This is interesting. It's an interesting problem that we struggle with, for sure. So, not, you know, every clarification, well, we can't really handle anymore right now anyway, so I could clarify it probably, but there's already so much wow around it, what we've been talking about, that, you know, I'd have to leave that to another time. If we see everything as vertical, Jesus actually says we'll lose all interest in bodies altogether. We won't even see them, he said, really, in terms of what we're used to thinking of seeing them. But we still can see nature, but in this vertical sense of everything is free of confusion right now. I see this as only my own training program, and I don't need to feel imperiled by my own training program. And I can't imperil myself. Only by believing that God has done this to us, or this has happened to us, can we feel truly imperiled. So we can see this freedom from imperilment and still see nature. Jesus says this is possible. This is the vision that we can have. So seeing nature in its very beautiful bucolic way, that could be somewhat helpful. I don't know. It's a double-edged sword. We cannot substitute it for practice, but it could be a way of acknowledging our elation that we're feeling, in terms of just the stillness, just the isness of nature, and just everything is just, it's perfect, just the way it is. No dynamic there. See, no dynamic. No imperilment. This kind of thing. It's possible. Of course, nature, everywhere we look, we see impairment. Absolutely. Now, a manicured golf course gives the impression of no impairment. This is what they try to give the impression of. Of course, golf itself is impairment. If you could just, like, drive around and walk a golf course, maybe that would be better than playing. They should just walk it, you know, just let's walk the course. It's like walk through a beautiful park, but they don't put as much effort into parks as they do golf courses, you know. So but we can't make the jump from beautiful nature to freedom from confusion. That has to be done through this practice here of seeing very clearly. So pure naturalism doesn't work. It doesn't really work. I know a lot of people have tried that. It doesn't work. But it could be maybe incorporated. I don't know. I've tried to incorporate it. I'd have to further clarification on this. What we'd be seeing is how beautiful and creative I've been in my, you know, in fashioning this training program of empowerment. But it's my, we have to recognize it's my training program. We've done this, you know. This is our training program. And we are all one, so we could say it's my training program too. I mean, so we're not imperiled. How can we be imperiled by our own training program and where, you know, where we can just stop it at any instant, change it at any instant, change anything at any instant, including the body, the notion that, you know, I am the body or the body is even imperiled. We can change that too. Jesus' crucifixion is to show the body's not really imperiled at all, actually. You think it is, but Jesus says, I don't, you can think it is, and I honor your, Jesus, I'm honoring the creativity. I'm accepting you as you are, that you believe that the body is truly imperiled. But then Jesus was resurrected and said, look, I'm showing you the body is not imperiled. You can choose for it to not be imperiled. See, there is nothing happening to you. He just agreed to go along with the crucifixion for the sake of then showing them that truly it is not imperiled, because they didn't believe him. He said, there's no way. If you die, you're dead. Body's dead. No, Jesus is not true at all. There is no dynamic of death, actually. There's no dynamic at all at play in this training program. It's just simply our own desire to try to prepare for a fixated creation. It's our own desire to suffer, thinking that this is how we prepare for a fixated creation. So we're entirely in control of every facet of this whole training program. And we can see that it is coming from us entirely, not from God at all. So there's no need for it at all, actually. And then we just see the pure creativity without the feeling of need. And with no feeling of need, there's no real feeling of imperilment either. It's along these lines. So this is it's very, very strong stuff here, of course. Now, of course, the impairment training program is ratcheting up its training. As I have said it would do, Holy Spirit is communicating this by using this communication device here to the world. Shorthand, I can say I have said this, but it's really coming from the Holy Spirit, is saying there's this, the imperilment vulnerability training program is ratcheting up its training because we're getting tired of this training. And so we think, oh my gosh, we got to make fixation real, because otherwise we're going to experience this terrible continuity. We got to get ready for this and be truly ready for fixated creation. Otherwise we're going to suffer terrible continuity fear. We don't realize that we already have a terrible continuity fear right in here, right now, but that we can work on that. So what they're doing is they're ratcheting up the imperilment vulnerability training by these various events that happen in the world. It's intentional. It's all intentional what we're doing. It's a training program. We know, we're aware that, you know, we say, okay, what do we need to do next to get ourselves really ready for fixated creation so we would be truly imperiled, you know, and get used to it so there's no continuity fear around it. This is what we're doing. So, of course, there's stuff happening. I said there would be stuff happening every day. The news is going to get terrible. Don't pay any attention to the news. I do not pay attention to the news. Holy Spirit told me, okay, this is enough's enough. It's time to stop. And I stopped. So, you know, maybe some of you have done the same, actually. Maybe struggling with a little bit. But again, you don't get familiarity with clarity by focusing on familiarity with confusion. It doesn't work that way. To believe it works that way is itself confusion. So just as a reinforcing confusion, we look towards clarity to get used to familiar with clarity. Obviously. And we think, why can't I see this? You know, continuity fear, that's why. So you'll have times when you're very clear, and then the wow will arise, and elation. What do I do with this elation? Oh my gosh, I'm a little nervous about this. And then you make that the new norm, and you don't invest it in this displacement mechanisms. Then you will have a greater clarity will arise for you, for sure. This has always happened for me. Bit by bit by bit, greater and greater and greater clarity. Always. I know in a day or two, if I'm really have a lot of wow. Hold on here. A day or two, if I have a lot of wow, that I will experience greater clarity. It will arise. It will arise. It will arise. So that there's the faith. You have to have faith that greater clarity is going to arise from your efforts. Otherwise, you're going to go to start displacing the elation and back right back into confusion as what you're familiar with. There's no way around it. So it's faith that you will make progress. And I could say for sure you will experience this on this path of full stop in the wow. When you do the full stop in the wow and stay on this path with determination, you will have these breakthroughs and say, oh my gosh, this is way clearer than I used to be. This is amazing. And then, of course, the wow rises from that, and then you go down a little bit, and you don't displace that, full stop in the wow. A little bit later, another breakthrough. You say, oh, this is even better than before. And it goes like that, and goes like that, and goes like that, and it's still going like that for me. I mean, this morning, the clarity I had was greatest the clarity I've ever had. It's absolutely stupendous. And I was just like, oh my gosh. I wasn't sure I could ever get to this. I just got to this. Oh, this is fantastic. This is tremendous. I was elated to get to this clarity. Elated. You know, just, I mean, the notion of freedom from confusion, of course we're going to be elated. Absolutely, we're elated. What's not to be elated about? I mean, we thought we'd be stuck with this confusion forever, and impairment and confusion. And to be free of it, it is serious. Oh my gosh, I'm not confused about this at all. This is just, you know, it doesn't get any better for us at this point, you know. This is just tremendous. So, how, you know, we want to, you know, sing a song to the world, and the world says, what the heck are you doing? You're crazy. So we say, oh, my elation is unacknowledged. I need to put it into some acknowledgement. Let me compose a song and write a song that people will like, and then they'll say, oh, your elation is coming from this song. Oh, okay. But I mean, I said, I want to sing a song of elation, of freedom, just spontaneous. And no, you can't do that. That's not how we do it here. And so there is this frustration, says, oh, this elation, what do I do? Get used to it. Just get used to it. Quietly. Simply, quietly, just get used to it. Now I can bust up my elation easily, just go play golf. And, you know, where's the elation then? It's like, oh my gosh. So it really is very humbling. It keeps you very humble in terms of, so okay, I don't know if that's a good thing though. This elation, you know, is best expressed quietly, silently, actually. Because there's nothing to put it into in this world except into everything, you see. And when you start singing a song to everythingness, then people, that's when people say, whoa, you know, you need to step that down into something we're used to there, son. And so silence is a great way of expressing this elation. So I would highly recommend silence, this positive silence, this elated silence, the silence of elation, The silence of pure elation. Just practice that. Practice the finish. This is the finish. The silence of pure elation. That it cannot be put into anything. It can only be put into everything and everywhere. That's all that will hold it. You know, that's all that will express it is everywhere and everything. Right now. So Ron Maharshi is a big help to us, really. Very big help. Very, very big help. Because he was the, you know, the great example of this. And silence is also conversation. He talks a lot about silence and how appropriate it is. How appropriate. And he acknowledges this. Acknowledges this silence. It's so appropriate. He says, I'm saying everything to everything. It's not a lack. It's a complete fullness, actually. But how do you express a complete fullness into a world that is based on belief in separateness and thinkness and fragmentation and fixation? Kelly said, I don't relate. You're not saying anything. But he said, no, I'm saying everything, to everywhere. It's a complete expression, he's saying. So this is, you know, we're very appreciative of Ramana Maharshi coming into this world and showcasing this. It's been invaluable help, actually. I don't have to adopt the same style of rhetoric that Ramana. We don't have to, you know. I have this own style here of this practice, full stop in the wow. It's not steeped in Vedanta, in, you know, Hindu Vedantaism. It doesn't have to be. I think it's better. I feel I like it better, actually. I mean, I like the style better. I mean, we're not going to sit around and argue about styles of music. You know, it's a matter of taste, really, if you want to look at it that way. But the silence part of Ramana Maharshi, which was what he really was showcasing, he really wasn't showcasing the way so much. He tried to simplify it as just inquire on the eye. He tried to cut out all this teaching. And he says, this is not really important. It's the presence that's important. So he's trying to showcase something for us. And so, you know, we're getting that now. We're starting to say, this is the value of it. This is the value of it. Same with Sri Sri Anandamaya Ma. She was showcasing the presence, the bliss, the peace, and not the teaching. So she really didn't have much teaching. And the teaching you try to put together into some sort of coherent, it doesn't really fit. Same with Ramana Maharshi. It's just like you try to get a coherent teaching from him. And he says, hey, forget all the questions. It's not about that. It's not about understanding liberation. It's about actually experiencing it. Focus on that, you know. Focus on the silence. He said those things. He said that. They kept making all these questions about him. He said, the answers to these questions are not what I'm here for. This is not where it's at. So, plain and simple. So we are tuning into what he had for us, the silence, which is the pure elation, no confusion, and only everywhere and everything and allness can adequately express this elation, you know. Put it into that context of silence. So, being silent, practicing silence, is a tremendous practice if you can do that. Those who can should do that. It is not a withdrawn silence. You know, it's again, it's this positive elation silence. I'm just so elated, I can't say anything. You know, I can only say everything. And how do we linearly say everything? The best way is through silence. You know, they tried to draw Ramana out and say, be linear, come on, give us this linear teaching. And Ramana says, you know, I'm so elated, I cannot express it in a linear fashion. It's everything. I'm you know, I have everything to say positively. You know, there's no confusion at all. It's vanished everywhere. I say, wait a minute, where did it vanish from particularly? And give me this linear thing. So this is not expressing my elation properly at all. And they struggle with that very severely. We actually have, in my opinion, some advantages over the Indian subcontinent because they're so used to defending against great teachers there. They're also used to great, it's a double-edged sword. They can be used to it and that's helpful, but they also have gotten very used to clever defenses against it. And that can arise, and does arise a lot. That's what Sri Sri Anandamayi said. She says, very few came to me for truth. And this is the Indian subcontinent, all the best and the brightest are there. She said, very few came to me for truth. That's pretty astonishing, isn't it? So they have very, very practiced defenses against it that seem very spiritual. They're asking very spiritual questions. What are you talking about? But they miss the whole point of it by doing that. Whereas here, we seem like country bumpkins, hillbillies, you know. But we don't have all this. Our defenses are not as sophisticated, actually. And that can be helpful if we're truly intent on freedom from confusion, you know, and freedom from this continuity fear. And if our defenses aren't so sophisticated, that helps us out, actually. It's very helpful. Because they keep wanting an expression of the elation step down into some linear explanation. This is not where it's at. Practice the silence. Practice the silence. Yeah, maybe they'll call us, you know. This is hillbilly, non-duality. Not really, not at all. I'm happy to be a hillbilly if that's the case. Let me be. Thank God I'm a hillbilly. Thank God I'm a spiritual hillbilly. This is great. Not out there tilting at windmills. Incessantly asking all these questions. Well, Shankara said this, that you'll be liberated. You have a body. You can come back in this body. Blah, 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 blah. Say, let's just practice the wow and not displacing our elation anywhere. Let's just work on that in this positive silence. I'm elated to be a hillbilly. I'm positively, silently elated to be a hillbilly. A lot thought Ramana was a spiritual hillbilly too. He lived at a hill or an Anjula. They said, why are you so silent? You don't have anything to say. You can't express it. Maybe you're confused. Happy to be a hillbilly. I'm elated to be a hillbilly. Hillbilly elation. Yeah, this is just hillbilly elation we got here. Hillbilly silence. We're practicing hillbilly silence. And they say, well, okay, I'll come back when you're ready to step it down into some linear stuff so I realize that it's not pure elation, you know. Don't want that. That doesn't help us get ready for fixated creation, is it? That doesn't help us get ready for what will never be. How can we evaluate nothing if you're just quiet? Come on, help us out, evaluate nothing. You gotta help us out. These are all defenses, you know, this questioning, though, that's defensiveness. Be a spiritual hillbilly, be quiet, listen, hear, see the clarity, experience the wow. Be a spiritual hillbilly, really. You'll find out that those hills are very, very nice that we live in, yeah. Be a perfect, yeah, I'm a spiritual hillbilly. I'm a perfect spiritual hillbilly, actually. Say that. I am a perfect spiritual hillbilly. Yes, I am a spiritual hillbilly, but I'm a perfect spiritual hillbilly. How dare you call me just a spirit? I'm a perfect spiritual hillbilly. Absolutely. This is the agree with your adversary practice, which I suggested too. It's a very powerful practice. Okay, all right, well, I got a date with frustration coming up. I'll try to turn into aesthetic experience. I'll work on that. Let's see if I can do that. It's not easy, but, well, No excuses. No excuses. I will do my best. I will do my best. I'm a perfect spiritual hillbilly. I'm striving to be a perfect spiritual hillbilly. Absolutely. You see, they displace the wow onto all these questions. This is as a displacement. When you see clearly, you don't have the questions. So why then we turn around and start asking the questions? That's obviously a displacement of the elation onto these linear questions that we can't handle. We're not establishing a new norm. You know, they've been asking these questions for thousands of years. Same old questions, blah, 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 blah. Hey, Ramana, there's a, you know, trying to appear sophisticated. This is just a, that's just normal for them. That's not establishing a new norm. So say, I am a perfect, yes, I am a perfect spiritual hillbilly right here, right now. And I'm totally elated to be so. Great. That's it for this one.